Okay. First of all, this is John Lane. If you guys are in the club, you know John. This is Elmer's son. My name is Bill Devine. Just a little background, and just to, so everyone's on the up and up. Got my first Model T when I was 14. Had them ever since. We have 9 now. None of them are anything special. They're just old Model Ts that we have fun with and drive with. I taught both of my boys to drive a Model T before they drove anything else, so that if they could handle driving a Model T, they could handle driving a modern car. We do own Bird Haven Vintage Auto Supply in Colfax, Iowa. We also have Texas Tea Parts, and John Reagan called us in June of last year and asked us if we would take over Fun Projects. He said that if we didn't take over Fun Projects, he was just going to quit. And talked it over with my family, and decided, we probably better jump in because they're good products, and you know, we want to keep Model Ts on the road, plain and simple. So we'll do our best. With John and I, we'll do our best trying to explain the Kansas City Warford, the differences between the original ones and this one. You guys got a good tutorial this morning of the original ones. And then from there, I'll take over and give you the very limited knowledge that I have on aftermarket accessory brakes, and maybe a little brake history and why they're necessary now, more so than what they were, you know, back in the Model T day. So this afternoon, we're going to talk about the Lane Kansas City Warford, and we're going to talk about accessory brakes. As you can see, Kansas City Warford is just as popular as it was back in the day. There's a run. I don't know if you, there's 6 on a pallet, and there's 6 pallets. That was one run.
That was the first run.
That was the very first run. John doesn't even have this picture.
No. I've seen it. Dad had it, but I don't know what.
Just a little background. Elmer, John's dad, came up with an idea in 2001 to put the racing gears
into these transmissions. The idea was to put them into the original cases, and then they found out that that just wasn't going to work. They was too wore out, and the most trouble they had was with the tops. They was having to make different shift rails for individual transmissions, and they just gave up and decided they had to do this. And it took them a little over a year to come up with the rest. And this is really, the gears in the original 18 will interchange with these, but basically nothing else. They had to completely redo it when they made it a completely modern transmission.
So these new ones are far superior as far as gear technology. As the gentleman said this morning, it's constant mesh, so it's nearly impossible to go into neutral. John says, well, it's impossible.
No, you can miss, but I tell you, whatever you do, quickly move the handle into somewhere. It's gonna go in. If it breaks something, I'm gonna fix it. But I've never seen one break anything from that. Basically, the only thing that's ever happened is not get the shift forks in, or something was really wrong in the metal before it went. And we only had one of those. We had one gear change.
I will tell you guys, we had a customer that sent us back some parts, and he said, there's something wrong with my transmission. Well, the problem was that he never greased the U-joint from the day that he put the transmission in the car. Never. There was literally nothing left of the U-joint. Nothing. It was the square part that went into the transmission was there, and the square part that went onto the drive shaft was there, and everything else was basically ground to nothing. Sent us the transmission also. I got in the van and I went down to Kansas City and we took it apart. And almost no wear on the teeth, 15 years. The guy had put thousands and thousands of miles on this thing. He took it apart, it was like brand new. The only thing John did was put a vent. This one doesn't have a vent.
Yeah, it does. Right.
Oh, yeah. Put a vent in the top so that the transmission could breathe. That was the only difference. Sent it back to him, explained to him that he had to, you know, had to grease things. We basically got him everything new they need to do. He put it back in. He says, this is better than it's ever been before. We didn't do anything to the transmission. But since he greased the U-joint, he thought, oh man, this, it's so much smoother, it's so much quieter. You guys are just awesome. It was just the U-joint. So these things, I don't care what anybody says, behind a Model T, they're bulletproof. And John has said that there's guys that do hill climbs that use them and they try and break them, they can't. I'm not trying to sell it, I'm just trying to say there's a big difference between these and those. So, you know, ask Jerome, you're gonna spend a lot of money repairing one of those and it's still cast iron. Not trying to sell it, just being honest. So, went through that. Now the other thing, I touched on it earlier this morning and I would really like to know if any of you guys have ever seen a support for a car transmission. Because we've searched and searched and searched and we were never able to find a support to support these transmissions when they bolt onto the back of the crankcase. We found them for trucks, but not for these. And I really think the reason why is if you put a support on here, like earlier this morning, you're taking the three-point suspension and you're binding it up. So the car's not able to flex, you know, like it was intended to. We know folks that, like I say, have thousands and thousands of miles with one of these on the back. No broken crankshafts. I mean, you know, if the car is set up correctly, you know, I don't think you're going to have any problems. If the car is not set up correctly, it doesn't matter whether you have one of these on the back or not, it's probably going to break the crankshaft. But this is a surviving example of a crankcase support for the pre-26-7 cars that don't have the two bolts that go through the hogshead into the back of the engine. They actually made those to try and keep the back end of the crankcase up where it belongs. When I first saw it, I thought it was a support for one of these. And then I got to reading and it's like, nope, that's just for the actual pan. And then there's a nice clean installation of a Kansas City Warford. John, you have to have other things to say.
I guess we can talk about when the original ones, when they first came out, the low gear ratio was about 1.7 or 1.87. And then along about 2008 or so, we got some guys in California said that it needed to have a higher low gear. And we started offering what we call the H1, which is a 1.57 low, which makes it about the same gear ratios as a Ruxel in low. And then in about 2 years ago, we started making this one, which is a for a TT, and that'll make the 523 gear come out to a 4.0 overdrive.
And they're great for speedsters too.
Speedsters
really like
and some people that are putting them in heavy cars with 4-to-1 rear ends, so it still goes fast enough once they get it wound up. That's something we don't usually keep these. We have the stuff to assemble. We have to put these together. So
we try and stock one. so that if they need one, somebody's in a hurry or whatever.
But we get them.
But they
as long as we have transmissions in stock, we're pretty good about able to get them.
So, any questions?
This isn't about the Warford, but what is that unit down there next to the frame on the right hand side?
You have a laser pointer.
Talking about that right there? That's an oil filter.
Okay.
That car has full pressure.
Okay.
That car's actually out of Oklahoma.
Thank you.
Do you know whose it is? They're from Oklahoma. Okay. Becky's tea.
Becky's tea. Yeah. Don.
Can't remember Don's.
Don and Becky.
Yeah. Sable.
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 Yeah, Don Sable.
Do either of you guys offer a modified drive shaft?
Oh yes. Yep. If you, I think you guys do the same thing. We have brand new drive shafts made.
Use the mic.
What? Here, you tell
them. Yeah, these we either shorten yours. Oh.
No. Oh.
Well.
Call.
I'm the one that don't talk loud enough. But we have these in stock always for when they send them in with bad keyways and stuff like that. But we will shorten your drive shaft and torque to you order.
And then we also shorten the torque tubes, and it's all done in a jig, so it's the proper length, and they're square, and they're indexed properly, and then it's TIG welded, so it's ready to go. Everything is sandblasted, and like I say, TIG welded. They're a nice setup. So if you send us yours, we'll shorten it up. Yep, new front bushing, and then it's the thrust surface is left raw so that you can put it, make it anywhere you need it to be. So, set and ready to go. They're a very nice unit, and the Lane family is a wonderful family to deal with. They've done their homework, and I have to tell you, the workmanship is above and beyond. It really is.
There's no place to cut a corner.
There is no place to cut a corner. Okay. No, you're right. There isn't. Nope. And they've made some good improvements in sending them out. They're now sent out without the shift tower on it. Comes with a tool, without the shifter on it, comes with a tool so that you can put it together. And then if you ever need to take it apart, you still have the tool to be able to take it apart, but it makes it much better than shipping. Since that's been done, it's almost impossible for UPS to damage it.
If you guys
were up looking at these earlier, this one earlier, you can see that this ear has been welded on this one. And it's because it was sent to Australia, and the customs people in Australia broke the transmissions so that they would have to be sent back to the United States because they didn't want them in Australia. So John just outsmarted them and made it so that he could package them so that they couldn't break them. Try as they might, right?
Right.
They still tried, didn't they? And I have to tell you guys, these things get shipped all over the world. Literally all over the world.
Spain, France, England, Germany.
You've had them in the transcontinental races and everything else, haven't you?
The one that got in the wreck, where it got rear-ended, I can't remember the guy's name.
I can't remember his name either right now.
But anyway, the car was pretty well totaled out and had one of our transmissions in it, and he had over 50,000 miles on it. my son tried to get him to send it back, and we was wanting him to give him a new one because we really wanted to look at the inside of it. So.
You wouldn't do it, would you? Wouldn't give it up?
It ain't bad.
He liked it too much. You wouldn't give it up. So, I don't know if you guys have any other questions or comments.
John, do you have a pattern or anything to reduce the length of the wishbone that goes with that kid or anything?
No, the instructions work just fine. You put your rear end and your torque tube together. You put your radius rods on them with them cutting two in the middle. Clamp them together, saw them, and weld them. We had no failures since we started doing it better. Yep. And Ben Hardeman came up with the idea. I just thought, boy, that looks easy, and it works.
And the only thing I'll add is it'd probably be good to measure and make sure that you've got everything square before you take the sawzall or whatever and cut them. And then I know guys that have taken some steel and put inside and then just riveted them. That way they'll still do some flexing. You can still do a, you know, a nice pretty weld on there to you know, halfway seal it up. But John's right, haven't had any break. They just go. You haven't heard of any problems, have you, Mike?
No.
No, just.
But I'm sure not everybody welds it in there like I do.
Right, and that's the thing.
I've only been on tour with one person so far, and it's been harder.
And we know his welding skills are suspect, right? No, I'm just kidding. I only pick on him because I like him. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Will the torque tube and the drive shaft work on both of them?
Sure. We've
any of them that are 12 inches long.
Right. The car ones. Yeah, we've sold quite a few to folks that have cast iron woofers.
Oh yes.
Can you give me a custom one? So I have a really good four wheel drive kit, so there's a transportation behind the woofer, so it'll be shorter. But if I measure, you could.
How short a drive shaft have we made for you, Mike? Oh, it's right over there in that car. Yeah, it's 30 some inches. So yeah, that young man sitting right over there does a really nice job.
Bill?
Sir?
Talk a little bit about rear end gear ratios with these transmissions. What do you think is really proper?
Well, it depends on what you're putting it in as far as an automobile. Personally, in a regular car, I don't like to go super fast. Speedster is something different, but in a regular car, I'm not a guy that really likes to
363.
To go. Yeah, or if you have a heavy car, 4:1. And even if, you know, depending upon what you're going to use the car for, you know, local tours and stuff. I've got cars that have 4:1 gears in them. I really like 4:1 gears. Just makes especially a later car, you know, 26.7 or whatever. Man, it just makes them so peppy. It makes them like an early car. You know, makes them like a, you know, 13, 14, 15. You know, just those early cars, especially the early roadsters. Man, they're just so nimble and so quick and so fun and so nice and fun to drive. But if you put 4:1s in a later car, it really makes it a lot more nimble and a lot more fun to drive. You know, perks it up quite a bit. I wouldn't put 3:1 gears in anything, not even a speedster, personally. I think it's the wrong way to go. 363, you know, maybe a 325.
Well, that's, if you put 4:1 gears, that's what high. Is
325.
Right.
You end up with 325 and 4:1.
Yeah, if you use 4:1 gears with a stock lane transmission, then you end up with 3.25:1 final drive ratio. So, you know, in overdrive, right? Final high gear, which is plenty fast in the Model T. And we'll get into the reason why I think it's plenty fast when we start talking about brakes and rear brakes and hydraulic brakes and some guys wanting to put four-wheel brakes on a Model T. We'll get into that as to why, you know, 35, 40 mile an hour is plenty fast in a stock-bodied Model T. A little bit of history on automotive brakes. Most of you guys have the PowerPoint presentation there, but first brakes on automobiles were nothing more than a cable wrapped around a drum that you grabbed a lever and pulled to try and stop the car. Cars went slow. Wasn't very many of them. All you had to dodge was horses and horse apples, so not a big deal. But you know, as cars became more prevalent and the speeds increased, brakes needed to get better. It's just all there is to it. They needed to get better. Ransom Olds is really the first guy to make some kind of breakthrough in automotive braking. And then, believe it or not, a doggone Englishman came up with mechanical disc brakes. And all this stuff happened right around the early 1900s. So, you know, people that say, you know, drum brakes and disc brakes and stuff are not proper for a Model T, it was around, okay? The technology was around. It wasn't completely thought out, but it was there. The ideas were there. There were some things, it was being used on some things and stuff all over the world. And then A.H. Raymond, Ray Bestas Company, you know, started in Connecticut in 1904, and, you know, they really went a long ways towards improving brakes. Duesenberg was the first one to use four-wheel brakes in Elgin Road Race that was put on by the Elgin Watch Company. That really made the news. That was really big time stuff. And that was in 1915, when Henry still had one brake drum in the transmission running in oil. Okay, it was out there. The technology was out there. And then Lockheed, from Lockheed Martin, you know, Lockheed Aircraft, he was the first guy that really made hydraulic brakes, or hydraulics in braking. They weren't real successful because they didn't have the technology to have good seals. So they were just using leather for the seals. So it leaked, they leaked off, you had to pump the brakes, you know, things like that. But still, it was there, and they were using it, and they were building it, and they were trying to perfect it. You got to start somewhere. You got to crawl before you walk. So I guess all I'm trying to get at is there's a lot of folks out there that say, you got to leave it as Henry built it. I love original cars, but if you're going to drive it, which I'm sorry, guys, the whole reason why myself and my family are in this business is to make sure that Model Ts stay on the road so the public sees them, so that they don't get relegated to museums. If we're not careful, sorry, I'm going to jump off on this, but if we're not careful, there's going to be long-eared guys in Washington that got some lobbyists talking to them, and they're going to make it so that we can't drive these cars on the road. So we got to keep them out on the road, we got to keep them in the public face, we got to keep getting the thumbs up, we got to keep giving the little kids rides, and we got to keep positive thoughts towards antique cars, or they won't be on the road. That's why we build the stuff we build, is so that they're more capable of staying with modern traffic and not become a moving chicane or a road hazard. Okay? Sorry, I just had to jump off on that because it's really important. It really is. You know? And the actually, the French came up, were the first ones to come up, believe it or not, with having one pedal to actuate all the brakes. Before that, you had a lever that you grabbed with one hand and you had to push on a pedal with the other hand. And then the driver had to modulate between the front and rear brakes by pulling on one and pushing on the other. That was back when guys were really drivers. You had to have some smarts and some stick-to-itiveness. Now, Henry Ford believed in sticking with things that worked. That's why we got 15 million Model Ts, over 15 million Model Ts. But he stuck with mechanical brakes until 1939. Wow. I mean, that's, I'm sorry, but that's dragging it out just a little bit too long. Because in, you know, 39 years, people were working with hydraulic brakes and different kinds of brakes, and they were being used on, yes, more expensive cars. But 1939? Come on, Henry. I mean, geez. Okay. I love this picture because that picture says it all. When Model Ts came out, at some point in time, that's the kind of road that the Model T was being driven on. Okay? A break in the transmission was perfectly fine for a road like that. As a matter of fact, it was excellent for a road like that, because it didn't get all the dirt and mud and sand and grit and gum and gunk in the braking system. So the car would stop. But the car wasn't going very fast either. And as you can see, maybe a wagon went down through there before him. There wasn't a lot of traffic on the road, so it wasn't super important to be able to stop on a dime. But as the roads got better, and there got more cars on the road, it was important to have better brakes. So, we're kind of doing this in alphabetical order. As alphabetical as a dumb guy from Iowa can get. You know, I may be off a little bit here and there. I don't know my alphabet as well as I should. So, AC, outside, contracting, band brakes on a steel Ford brake drum. Okay, at least maybe you had the emergency brake on the inside that was made out of cast iron to try and help and keep that drum round and to size, so that when the band clamped down on the drum, it didn't deform the drum a whole lot, but it did get hot, and then it would be just like skating on ice. So the drawbacks of the system are not a whole lot of contact area on a small drum. The brake material is exposed to the elements. A lot of them didn't work real well in reverse. They didn't work real well when wet. So that's kind of the drawbacks of the outside band type brake. Bennett brakes. Same thing, different manufacturer. This is actually an aftermarket creation of the Bennett brake system. Anchor point is more in the center, so they work better forward and reverse than some of the others. Nice brake setup, really is. A lot of the same drawbacks. Big four. Okay, I think I've seen one set of four-wheel band type brakes from the period. And I can see why now. All the levers and gizmos and brackets and clamps and everything that were on those, how in the world could you keep that working for very long? It would wear out, you know, get all the dirt and grit and sand and water and everything in there and would go to heck. The other problem with the brakes on the front is the kingpin inclination and the Ackerman is all wrong to have brakes on the front of a Model T. But again, they weren't going very fast. And they didn't grab real hard. Yeah, it was probably an improvement, but it wasn't like a Corvette. Lockwood brakes. These are period accessory brakes. They're also actuated by a cable. Same drawbacks as the AC or any of the other ones. Seemed like everybody on every street corner was making brakes for Model Ts, just like all the other accessories. McNary, another four-wheel brake company. The only difference is they had larger drums, came with all the stuff. Still, same drawbacks, just a bigger drum. Same thing again, you know. Non-skid brakes. Why do you suppose they could say non-skid? You couldn't put enough clamping force on the drum to slide the tires. But you had twice the area, so it probably did slow the car down faster, you know. But still, it's kind of funny. Installs in 1.5 hours with no drilling or alteration resulting in a, you know, no more chatter, no more this, no more that. I mean, it's the greatest thing since sliced bread. Heed, same deal. Copy of the ACs, or AC copy Ds, I'm not sure which. But uses the stock Ford drum, goes on there. Ton trucks, $16.98. Regular car, $10. Brand new brakes for $10. Anybody want to get on the list? Here's the late model Rocky Mountains. Not bad mouthing anyone's product, but these were redesigned from the original. We have some an original one up here. Look at the original Rocky Mountain setup and look at the reproduction, completely different. Hardly anything at all the same. They changed the anchor point on these, and again, don't work in reverse, don't work real well in wet weather. I will say a lot of folks buy these and take those off because they say, man, I hold on to the steering wheel, pushing as hard as I could, and the car just rolled right down the driveway backwards, right out in the street. You know, or I killed the engine and the car rolled a block and a half down and through an intersection and I hit the curb and finally stopped. There's nothing I could do. Okay. So, beautiful product. Man does a wonderful job. Royal Contracting Brakes, that's Raybestos. Instead of being cable operated, they're rod operated. Came from Bridgeport, Connecticut. A lot of this stuff was from out east where all the population was and where all the mechanical technology and metallurgy really came from. Todd Smith, four-wheel brakes. We didn't get them all, but man, it just goes on and on and on. There's tons of them. Never seen them, never seen a real pair of them. $37.50 for four-wheel brakes. Comes with pedal and everything. Okay, now we move forward, kind of in today's world. Need for hydraulic brakes in modern traffic. You saw that first picture where the guy was driving in the mud. Now this is what we're exposed to today. Big trucks, multi-lanes, all kinds of traffic. And we're trying to compete for our little spot on the road. Okay, now we have ABS and four-wheel discs and
advanced braking systems.
Yeah, all this stuff. Some cars, the car puts the brakes on for you. Okay, and we and our Model T's got to compete with that. Because the people that are driving those cars, they have big S's on their chest. Nothing will hurt me. I've got my airbags. I've got my anti-lock brakes, I've got four-wheel disc brakes, I've got 18-inch tires. You know, I can go anywhere, I can do anything. They zip in and out in between you, they pull right in front of you, they do all that stuff. hydraulic brakes. If you look on there, that's a wagon. In 1910, wagon builders were putting hydraulic brakes on wagons. Now let's step back. Ford didn't put hydraulic brakes on cars until 1939. Wagon builders were putting hydraulic brakes on wagons in 1910. Because they understood that with a hydraulic brake system, it wasn't on or off. You could do it gradually. With mechanical brake system, because of the mechanical leverage needed, it's harder to modulate the braking force. Much easier with hydraulic brakes. So that really tells you a lot right there. So when people tell you that a Model T, hydraulic brakes weren't around when Model T was built. Sorry guys, it was there. Okay, so now we fast forward to the 80s. Gentlemen out east, as I remember it, that built hydraulic brakes for small drum rear ends. Problem was, that was early 80s. $770 for two backing plates. That's kind of expensive. Drawbacks with it was the wheel cylinder was very small in diameter, so you had to push very hard on the pedal to try and force the brake shoes out. And there just isn't a lot of friction area on a small drum for adequate braking of a car that weighs 1,800 pounds. And you were still doing it on a steel drum. So that steel drum flexes when you put that pressure on those shoes. So that didn't last long. I think I've been told that they sold like a half a dozen or a dozen kits. Has anybody ever seen one? See, I don't think they didn't get, did you, have you seen one? Have you ever, did you get to drive the car or anything? Did you? What did you think of them? It worked pretty good. Was there a lot of pedal pressure to take? Okay. I didn't know. You know, I've never gotten to drive a car with one with a set on there, but you know, I've talked to a lot of guys that tried to put them on their car or put them on their car, so that's where my experience comes from.
Gary,
and then, go ahead.
Gary Hilton has hydraulic brakes on the back of his name, don't you? Rock Mountain? Okay. I can't correct
you. So I found these. I have no idea who the builder is. I've got one half of it right up here. If anybody can tell me anything about them, it'd be great, because it's really a neat setup. It's for a large drum rear end, has a cast iron drum, laser cut backing plate, nice little wheel cylinders, neat little setup. No idea who built them, but they're a neat idea. They really are, and those would be good. Good brakes, because the master cylinder, the wheel cylinder, is a fairly decent size, so there's not a, you know, there's some good power there. And then, not trying to advertise, but this is the system that we sell. And the advantages to our system is it's a complete kit. Everything is in there that you need, right down to the hand wipes to clean your hands when you're done, so that when you go in the house, you don't get the wife's towels dirty. We have lots of friction area. The reason why we use such a large four-piston caliper is so that you don't have to apply a lot of pedal pressure when you're trying to stop, and you can stop more controlled. You know, you don't just have to give it everything you got just to stop the car. You can nice and gently, or if you need to, you know, you can really put them on, and you can modulate it so it's not just skidding the tires. You know, you can you can do it gradually. Yeah, they're disc brakes. They're on a Model T. Safety trumps. Sorry. I mean, if there was a better way to do it, you know, large drum rear end does have sufficient surface area for a internal drum brake, but small drums, it's just not big enough. Sorry, guys. I mean, that's just all there is to it. You know, it's important to be able to keep up with the cars that are on the road now. Four-wheel hydraulic brakes. It's been done for many years. There's a right way and a wrong way. Again, my opinion. I'd love to hear, love for you guys to tell me that I'm full of crap. I'd love to have discussion with you about this stuff. Because if I have discussion with you guys, I learn. Thank you. Tell me why. Okay?
That was Mike's opinion.
That's the editor. That's editorial. Four-wheel hydraulic brakes were around in the day. This is from June 1926. Four-wheel hydraulic brakes. They were there. They were on the market. They were had. I wouldn't drive with a set of those in today's traffic. Nash Metropolitan, everybody's done, or a lot of people have done this conversion. Dangerous, as far as I'm concerned. Very dangerous. Here's another one that, to me, is very, very dangerous. And if you guys will look, there's a Panhard bar that this gentleman is trying to correct things. If you look back here, it's got a shock absorber on the steering, okay? And the whole reason why he's got all that stuff on there is because when he puts the brakes on and one tire is trying to stop and the other tire is on a slick surface, it will literally yank the steering wheel out of your hand. And it will feel like that car is coming apart. It's all kinds of violent. So that's why they're doing all these things to try and band-aid the real problem. They're not fixing the real problem. Okay? Here's an example of the correct way to do it. Whoops. Doggone it. I'm sorry, guys. Kingpin inclination. The kingpin, the line in the kingpin needs to be at the same contact point as the tire when they intersect when it hits the ground. Look at the modifications that had to be done to this front axle to be able to get the correct kingpin inclination to be able to safely and properly run front brakes. There was a lot of work done to that. Then they had to make their own spindles. Look at the angle that the spindle is on to keep the tire in the correct plane after you change the kingpin inclination. What isn't shown on here is they also changed the Ackerman, which is the turning radius, which helps with the steering. Also, there's a steering box on the car, not the steering gear up on the head, just below the steering wheel. That is the proper way and the only way to safely, in my opinion, to put front brakes on a Model T. And it's just a little itty bitty guy. That's a single piston caliper Wilwood. And that's a little itty bitty, I think it's 10 and a quarter or 10 and 7/8 inch diameter disc. They're not very big. But you can see how they've shortened this up and changed the angle. Okay, come at me. Tell me why I'm wrong, please. I want to hear it. Or if you have any questions. I told you it wouldn't be as professional as this morning. But I think we got some pretty good information. I don't know. You guys tell me.
Two more reasons not to do it. Okay. Wishbone is not strong. That's why it's got six little marks.
Yep.
And the next thing is it's going to hook right into the oil thing.
It's going to what?
The wishbone hooks right into the oil
thing. Yep.
Then the kingpins aren't strong enough. There's the size to take it from. And then the next thing is wooden wheels. Wooden wheels won't.
That's why you buy a set of these. It just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger, you know?
When you were talking about the drum brakes that are over there, and you know, I understand that you don't, there's no manufacturer of those currently, but I just wanted to mention I do have hydraulic drum brakes on the back of my 1926 touring car. I did not do the conversion. It was that way when I got the car back from having been gone for quite a few years. But it's very similar to what you've got on the table, and the fact that it's, I think, early Chevy, 50s Chevy drum and shoes that were modified in such a way that not only did the brake actuate with the pedal, but the handbrake also mechanically actuated the drums as well. So you had a mechanical backup if you did have a hydraulic failure.
Yep, and that's the way these are too. And that's one thing I will tell you, I don't care what brakes you put on a Model T, I don't care what they are at all. You better leave the Ford service brake in the transmission. And it needs to work. Okay? The way our kit is set up is the hydraulic brakes come in first. And if the pedal goes beyond a certain point, the Ford brake kicks in. Right. You never want to disable, as poor as it is, you never want to disable the brake in the transmission. All these are an accessory add-on brake. Period. Yes, sir.
I got a couple questions and a comment. What kind of brakes are on Mike's car, the speedster back here? Because it didn't look like any.
That's a set of Rebets.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Like an AC.
Right. Sure. So the comment I have, I bought a whole set of brakes at Chickasha last year with the linkages and pedal hookup and everything. And I posted a picture of them on one of the forums. Nobody's been able to identify them. And if anybody knows what brand those are, I'd love to hear about them. I just brought them as a show and tell and to see if anybody knows anything about them. It says patent applied for, and it says number 91, but there's no brand name on it. So I'll be around if anybody knows anything about it.
Lots of cool forgings. It's neat how they actuate.
Yeah, it's got kind of a scissor action, quite a bit of mechanical advantage, and it's rod actuated. It hooks up to the brake pedal, and then there's another linkage that kicks in when you pull the emergency brake back or the parking brake. So it's a pretty good setup, well thought out setup, but I don't know anything about them. So my question is, can we talk a little bit about, for those of us with mechanically actuated external brakes, like original Rockies or ACs or those brake materials. So I know there's Green Grabber that's on the reproduction ACs. There's brake material with like copper threading through it. And I just want, you know, some are noisier than others. Probably some work better when dry or wet than others. And is there sort of a go-to material, for example, when I go to reline those, that I should be avoiding or using?
Anybody?
McMaster Car has a gray line. It's not metal filled. I use those on my outside brakes. They're soft enough to where they feel good. They will stop you. But it's, if you go into their catalog, they on the liners, it's a gray.
kind of a light charcoal gray material.
No, no, it's just...
It's a friction material.
It's just friction material. It's just friction banding.
So, copper, is that what Aspen uses for copper threading?
The reason why the copper impregnated material is used is it combats the dirt and the grit and the oil and the grease and things like that. It was very popular in the day, but that's why it is used, plain and simple.
The green dragon material depends on the ACs. I can't ever get them to stop.
Any other questions or comments or? Yes, sir.
When you're setting these up, like your Rocky Mountain break and then your drum break, you're going to try and get them to grab at the same time, but then you're getting band wear in your drum, in your transmission.
Now the way we have it in our instructions is that the auxiliary brakes work first.
Okay.
Then if the pedal goes past a certain point when you're pressing it, then the band comes into play in the transmission.
Okay.
You know, it's your backup. It's your Hail Mary.
Okay.
When you start saying cuss words, that's when that brake is being used.
Or reverse.
Or reverse, yes, but sometimes that's not a good thing. You know.
Now, the Rocky Mountains don't work in reverse.
The current production ones, I've been told, and I have current production Rocky Mountain brakes on a 26 Roadster, and going backwards, they're just not there. I mean, they are just not there. And if you look at those compared to the ones you brought in, completely different animals. Those work good in reverse, from what I'm told. But are they original ones, or are they like that?
They're like that. And fundamentally, I don't use them. I just use the board brake.
The other thing that I've been told about these, and I don't know, I don't drive my Roadster enough, is it's tough to keep them in adjustment. Does anybody have any experience with that as far as... And then the other thing that I've been told, we have a couple of customers that would buy springs from us quite often because some of the springs break, and then you can't just buy the spring that breaks. He makes you buy all three springs. So you gotta buy all three springs and you only need one. Because, you know, he buys them in sets and he doesn't want to just sell one. I can completely understand that. You know. But no, they work great going forward.
For those of you looking, from my understanding, there's actually a middle set, which I have seen, that was built in the 60s, I think.
Late 60s.
It's the current style bands, but it's a cast iron drum. So it's marginally better than those in breaking, not as good as the originals. The original, there's one up here on the table, but the originals are like the AC and these brakes I brought in, they're self-actuating. Half the band is self-actuating in forward and half the band is self-actuating in reverse. Because these are pinned on one end and pull all the way around, they have better braking going forward maybe, but they're not self-actuating at all in reverse. So this middle era that I'm talking about, unfortunately, are like this as well, but they do have cast iron drums, and then there's an inner drum for the emergency brake. So those of you who are out looking around and trying to decide what to do, if you come across a set of those, they're basically going to perform like this, maybe a little better in terms of the heat and whatnot on the cast drum.
Cast drum is the best part of it. It really is. A I hope you guys weren't underwhelmed. Did I do okay? Did
yes,
I answer
sir.
Any questions?
Right.
I'm not here all week. I don't do three shows. What do you think, Jerome? Oh, got a question?
What's the installation time for a set of your disc brakes?
Depends on how good you are. The hardest part of installing our brake system. You're not very good. I mean, that's what I've been told anyway. The hardest part everyone says about installing our brakes is getting all the air out of the lines because everything is brand new. It's really not fair for me to answer that question because, you know, we've done enough of them that it doesn't take us very long. Most folks love it as a weekend project. What's that?
Leading the brakes.
Right.
The boy told me out of Arkansas, jack the front end up as high as you can get it.
Yep, that helps.
It worked.
Yep.
I thought it was a 2 hours ago. And it worked.
Yep, we tell folks on the phone to do that if they have a problem. Believe it or not, we have a lot of guys that have airplanes or that are airplane mechanics. And what they tell us is that on airplanes, it's mandatory that they bleed the brakes on an airplane from the wheel up to the reservoir. So they put their pump, basically, and they pump brake fluid in from the caliper back up into the reservoir. To 10 minutes, they're done. Down the road, they go. But you know, not everybody has one of those fancy things. You know, that's the hard dirt. It's expensive, and not everybody has that. So. What's that? Oh yes.
And it'll bleed itself.
You think so? Man, I've had guys that just.
Gravity works wonders.
Always bench bleed the master cylinder. Always bench bleed the master cylinder first. That helps a bunch. Other than that, I'm with John. A lot of times what we'll do is we get done with it, we'll crack the fittings on there and go to lunch or go do something else. Come back, and we've got a couple rubber tubes on there going down into a pop bottle or a pop can. Come back, reservoir goes down about that far, tighten them up. Done. You know, it's all about being patient. Patience? I've been told that if you have girls, you learn patience. I don't know if that's true or not because I was blessed with two boys. So.
No, you learn real quick that you are not in charge.
Oh, you're not in charge? Okay. Well, you would know.
I know.
Because you're the lonely man in the house.
Even have female dogs.
But I do want to tell you, there's a gentleman in Iowa that makes McLaren wire wheels now. This is a customer's, one of five that a customer did. These are probably the fanciest wheels he's ever done. Triple chrome plating, all polished, stainless steel spokes. The man builds beautiful wheels. They're straight, they're true, they're strong. They go on original 6-bolt wood wheel hubs. So you don't have to buy any special hubs. You don't have to buy any special bearings. You don't have to buy any of that. It comes with the hardware to mount it on your 6-bolt hubs. And if you have a car where you're tired of the rickety wood wheels, these are a nice alternative. They really are. They're straight, they're true. Makes a big difference in the way the car goes down the road. But since we since we had the five of them, they haven't left yet. I thought I'd bring it and show it and show it off. Pardon me? Non-chromed, just a bare wheel ready to paint. They're $775 a piece. That's, you know, brand new fellows, you know, spokes, hubs. This is a forged steel center that's CNC machined. This is marine bronze billet, the cap is. They're nice wheels. And he does do some various different sizes, some different configurations. So as you can see, they can be customized, you know. I had to bring them for eye candy. I had to bring one for eye candy, that's all. Just, you don't get to see that kind of thing very often, so.
It's probably made you pay $1,000 deposit.
Me? No, I didn't have to pay any deposit. Here's the thing. My son over there and I, we have to put tires on these wheels without scratching. The reason why I have it is we're still waiting for tubes. Because you have to have special tubes for that, for what the gentleman wants. But any other questions, anything we can help with? Like I said, yes, sir. Did you have a question? Okay, never mind.
You know, yes. One thing I never liked about the disc wheels is to me that it just looks too big. Is there any chance they're ever, this whole thing's ever going to be made smaller?
The small drum is about as small as you can go. The small drum disc. The large drum is the size that it is because of the drum. It's basically as small as it can go, you know. Here's what I'll tell you. Majority of the people that get a set of brakes, if they have two or three cars, they call up and they say, I hate you. Why? I don't understand. What's wrong? You know, the first time I was really concerned. I took it to heart. I didn't understand what the man was saying. He says, you don't understand. He says, I have three cars. He says, my wife bought me brakes for Christmas. He says, in the car that we tour in. He says, because she wanted to be able to stop. He says, now that's the only car we drive. He says, so now I have to buy brakes for my other two cars, so we'll drive them. So I don't care what they look like. I'm with you.
If you're going to haul your wife,
they're kinda,
or your kids, or your grandkids, I'm sorry, safety trumps.
So, I mean, I'm kind of with you. They're yeah. Kind of ugly on a Model T.
They're kind of ugly on a Model T, but safety trumps.
They work. And like I say, it's kind of like having power brakes. You know, you don't have to. And the older you get, the harder it is to, you know what I mean? With these, it's easier. It really is. You can ask Bill, you can ask Ted, you know, Mr. Kyle, you can ask him. You don't have to take it from me. And we are in the process of changing the kit. So it is going to cost a little more. They're all going to come with braided steel brake lines to go from the caliper to the radius rod. And they're all going to have clips that go on the radius rod for the stainless steel braided line to hook to, so there will be no more zip ties. And the master cylinder is going to change. So there's going to be some, we're trying to make it easier, cleaner, safer, you know, the whole nine yards. So we've had some increases that we've absorbed to this point in materials and but when we make the changes, we're going to have to raise the price a little bit. The price has been the same for
ever.
Long time. The current set for a Model T car is $1,125. We also make them for TT trucks. And the TT truck ones have been used on railroad cars, speeders. For a railroad coach. There was another thing that was mounted on a TT chassis. We just sold a set to a movie company that they had to put an electric motor in their TT truck because the sound of the engine was fouling, or the ignition system was messing with the new sound system that they were using. So they put an electric, they took the engine out and put an electric motor in. It bolts in just like the engine bolts in, uses the torque tube and everything, but then they had no brakes. So we sold them a set of disc brakes for their TT truck that they use in the movies. And then we got a big disc to go on the back side of the wheel so that it covers the brakes up so that the shiny part of the disc didn't reflect back into the camera. So they get used on lots of different things. They really do. Any other questions or anything? Otherwise, I'm sorry, I don't have anything more for you.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. I was hoping maybe to get Mike to talk about his speedster racer for a minute, since I had a few questions.
Come on,
you
up,
going
Mike.
To converse? Oh, I don't have any questions. I just thought maybe you might answer all of the questions you usually get in one little spiel.
Well, the reason I built the car was I was tired of Nick Nicklaus having yeah. all the fun.
The car, a couple of idiots, friends of mine in Illinois, up to Tacoma, Washington, and basically bought the frame, front end, the chassis, all the cute little racing bits was all with it from Steve Tomasa, and got it home and eventually ended up taking it over to my good friend Bill Howells, and that's how come everything's powder coated. That's all I'll tell you about that. You'll have to talk to Bill on the rest. But at any rate, I had this C head. It's a Ruth 16 valve type C, 4 2¼-inch exhaust, 4-inch and I believe 7/8 intakes. Roof started making that head in about 1923. Don't know how many he made. There's not a whole lot of information on it, but it was there was an article where Roof took it, put the car together in 23, and he built what he called number 13, it was the Ford Flyer. There's some pictures of it around, and he built it to advertise the head, and he claimed he broke the speedometer at 105 mile an hour and said there was more throttle to go, boys. So who knows? I wanted a dirt track racer, and I had that head for 15 years, Nick, I suppose. Had it forever. I was going to build. An engine and put together because my good friend that we've all lost, Gary Lefevre, he was known as kind of Mr. Speedster at hill climb events around here. And he wanted a Type C and couldn't find one, so he ended up using the Rajo. And I'm bored to death at any rate. I'm just sorry I never got it together in time, so we could have ran just for giggles and wiggles. The car, supposedly, you know, it's one of these stories and there's no documentation on it, but supposedly the remains that was recovered by, actually it was gave to Steve in 1994, supposedly some old timers around remembered the car running on dirt tracks. If it would have ran on sanctioned tracks, it would have ran between 22 and 28 when they outlawed single seat bobtails because of safety issues. It did come with a body. I built the engine up. It's a Whippet radiator that I stole from John Steele, and don't let John know that the radiator cap on it, which is his, is mine now. But at any rate, The body, I fabricated it with the help of Bill's wife. She's a sewer, and I needed a pattern, and I said, well, you can probably make a pattern, and her and I built that body. We got, it was a lot of fun doing the project.
She really built it.
Huh?
She really built it.
She really did. She really did. So it's a hill climb car is what it'll probably see more service of, but it's an 88-inch wheelbase. That was dirt track back in the day. And speaking of dirt track, those of you that are interested in trying to stay in a car, Abilene, Texas, September the 20th, I think, we've leased the dirt track. And so we're gonna go down and...
And a hill climb.
And a hill climb, yeah, we're gonna do it.
A flat hill climb?
Sure, no. It's a flat hill climb. Hey. When was the last time he was on a hill where there was a real hill? But at any rate, it's just something that I wanted to do and had the opportunity and had all the parts kind of gathered up over, you know, you collect stuff down again. It's full pressure, scat crank, scat rods, custom made Ross pistons, eight and a half to one, I think is what I went for, 8.5 to 1 compression. We took it out for the first run in September at Northwood, and it was kind of like me showing up at the OK Corral gunfight with a knife, and a small one at that. Had some problems, ran out of gas.
Aren't you showing up with a small one?
Pardon?
Huh?
Nothing? ran out of gas, thought I had that all figured out. I had to listen to Bill every time I got up there, him trying to tell me everything that I did wrong, because he was the flagman, him and his wife, him and his family put on that, by the way, or provide all the timing equipment and stuff. So it's a lot of fun. This is a different part of the Model T hobby. It's not for everybody, because you gotta go a long ways to go have fun with it. But I don't know the top end on the car. The last run I made, I turned 9.9, something like that. Nick won in Model T at 9.3, so 0.6 seconds behind him. Didn't think that was too bad, but it was a long strip. I got to stay in it, and I decided I wanted to live to see 71. Got that fast. Got scared. So it's just a lot of fun. Different part of the hobby. Yes, any questions?
That's pretty good.
Thank you. I'm glad if you enjoyed looking at the thing, I'm glad I brought it for you.
Thank you, Mike.
How much was the attendance?
We had mid-50s.
Stayed away.
Certainly not our largest, but about right.
Is he all done? Drop the weights. That's really fun.